As a child, they kept him in a crumbling house, a building with structural moans, whose eaves cracked in summer heat and gathered winter ice. At that point, Muldinki's chest held two lungs and a single heart. He experienced a shortened boyhood, a small degree of youth and carelessness. Most phenomena puzzled him and sent him on aimless walks among the leafless ether trees. He would fix on his goggles, his gauze pad, and study the flying birds, see them casting frightened earthward glances. He would press his face against the pane of his bedroom, look out as spring fell, and wait for the green bird. The green bird would circle a dying ether, peck spirals on its dry trunk, writing down its habits, behaviors, and essences.
Followed by pauses, long, agile tongue coated with a jelly-like substance, good for rooting in tree trunks, for larvae, etc.
Things were loose in those days for Muldinki. He was free and new green, bright suns behind him, spirals ahead. Dinky's faith diminished.
If he opened a spigot and got water, no matter how clouded or sour, he was gratified, as though he no longer expected it.
Although he loved water as nearly as he loved anything.
At one time, while Dinky enjoyed the oncome of winter, greeted it with a flourish of ritual activity. He was comfortable in a state of cold, twigs snapping underfoot with icy reports. The air was never still enough for Moldinky's comfort until it was heavy with frost or wet with sleet. When the new snow came, he would go out and piss his name in it. As years succeeded, the rituals went on. He noted the fall of the last leaves,
please.
Well, Dink, he had done that, and Bernhard had said...
As I thought, Dink, you grow more like a gopher every season. I know it's not the cold you like so well. No, it's the defensive pleasures of remaining warm within the cold, it's that. Quick to cocoon, but slow to change. It's an old tale.
Summerfall came differently. He would watch the earth dry and crack in repeated patterns. Green birds came and land turtles walked over the country roads. Surly grasshoppers baked in the sun's light. Rising temperatures set Moldenki on the defensive, causing him to speed from A to B, from thought to thought, from one thing to the next thing.
Pace yourself.
Bernhard had told him one summer fall.
Pace yourself, or you'll never make it in the army.
Earlier in the mock war, he had volunteered for injury, writing his number down
on a square of paper, dropping it in a metal box outside the semi-colonel's office.
At morning meal, the day's injury volunteer list was read. Moldenki would eat his prunes and potato milk and wait. And when they read his name,
he reported to Building D.
Stood in line at the door.
Every minute or so, the line shortened by one.
The mock soldier in front of Moldenki turned and said,
I'm proud that I gave for my country.
He opened the fly of his trench pants and showed Moldenki a headless crank.
I'm a vet, boy. What are you giving up?
Moldenki was about to admit a minor fracture
when the veteran's turn came up.
Moldenki asked him before he went in the door
what he would be giving up this time.
The veteran shaped his hand into a gun and pointed a finger towards himself, cocking his thumb. During Moldenki's minute outside the door, a gun fired as someone shoveled smoking bones into a pile at the side of the building. A red light blinked above the door jamb.
Moldenki snorted.
The green light went on, and Moldenki stepped into the prep room.
A table, a jellyhead mock doctor in a swivel chair.
Moldenki crossed his hands behind his back
and waited. The Jellyhead pushed colored plastic wafers into configurations
in the desktop.
A circle.
Across inside the circle.
Moldenki
coughed honestly, and the Jellyhead looked up, turning a knob
on his throat box. Moldenki said,
"Moldenki, sir, minor fracture."
The Jellyhead swiveled in a corner turn and looked at the chart of seasons on the wall.
Moldenki said,
"Moldenki, sir, minor."
The Jellyhead said,
"You, I heard. Weather is the outside how?"
Moldenki waited for the correction. The Jellyhead said, "Correction, I heard you. How is the weather outside?"
Moldenki said,
"Not bad. A little blister snow last night, not bad."
The Jellyhead swiveled a half turn and adjusted his word order bubble. Swiveled back, his headlight shining in Moldenki's eye.
What are you giving up, General Moldenki?
Moldenki mentioned the minor fracture. The Jellyhead arranged the colored wafers into a square containing other wafers.
How brave you are, Moldenki. I just this last minute shot a two-week vet in the spine. A day ago, I had occasion to remove the longest inch he had. One day that, the next day, his life. What do you think, Moldenki? Your minute is getting older. Is a minor fracture enough? Ask yourself that.
Moldenki experienced guilt. Agreed to give up a list of feelings in addition to the minor fracture. The Jellyhead seemed satisfied. Told Moldenki to follow a corridor to a number two fracture room and have a seat. He waited in a cold chair in the fracture room, flipping through magazines. Music played.
In a while, feet shuffled in the corridor.
And a Jellyhead nurse came into the fracture room.
Moldenki smiled and said, "Hello." A nurse sat on a stool in front of him and told him to cross one leg over the other. She scissored open the trench pants, exposing the kneecap. Moldenki looked at the ceiling light. The nurse, in one experienced stroke with a chromium ball peen, broke the kneecap. He lay in the shock room under a clock piece. When he opened his eyes, the Jellyhead doctor stood over him.
"How do you feel, Moldenki?"
Moldenki sat up and said he didn't know. The doctor said, "Good. The war is over now. Go home. Stay in your cot for a few days and then go home."
He had been standing in the downtown rain, waiting for an uptown K-bus. A boy rode by on a K-cycle, skidding in an oil puddle. Falling on the sidewalk at Moldenki's feet. Moldenki crabbed backward, jelly on his shoe. A crowd gathered and someone mentioned Jellyhead. It had been his first encounter.
He built himself in the auditorium. A dome, angles, vertical walls, everything suggesting architecture. Ushers walked the aisle collecting chits. Bunce was in Texaco City to speak to the folks.
Moldenki ate popcorn.
Someone whispered,
"Bunce?"
Everyone stood up.
Moldenki remained seated and lit a cigar.
Bunce delivered the standard speech.
"I appear before the folks tonight with sorrow under my tongue. You have patiently endured while the moons were down for repairs. Now as we together approach the terminus, I ask you to turn on your flashlights.
Lights in the auditorium went out and flashlights were turned on. Bunce asked if there were any questions.
Muldinky raised his hand.
Bunce said,
"No questions."
Muldinky stood up and whirled his hand in circles above his head.
Bunce said,
"I see no hands."
Someone next to Muldinky said,
"He can't see you. Turn on your flashlight."
Muldinky didn't have a flashlight. Two jellyheads approached and asked him to step into the aisle. They searched through his coats and shirts and reversed his pockets, made him kneel. Bunce said,
"Look at that example, folks. Shine your lights on that man."
The audience turned to watch, focusing their beams on Muldinky. One of the jellyheads said,
"Take down the pants."
Muldinky took down the pants. A second jellyhead came forward, wearing a rubber glove, and said,
"Bend over. We need some readings."
In the old days, his radio to the weatherman, his radio on through the short nights, the face of it green and glowing. The rosy forecasts, the cocksure predictions. If the weatherman said warm, Muldinky opened the lookouts, found icicles in the morning on the faucets. When the weatherman said chilly, he would turn up his collar and close the lookouts. In the old days, there was one sun, one moon, and starlight enough, and one good heart.